right. So you guys remember rectilinear motion? So we've talked about this a couple times already, just in different contexts. But now that we have talked about antiderivatives and the integral, it's worth a revisit. So let's recall the acceleration function a of t. So let's say assume specifically that a of t is constant. So the big kind of the important example here is think of gravity, right? So you drop something or you throw something in the air, and the acceleration is constant, whatever the gravity is, right? Let's see. So let's say you have, so a of t, if it's constant, well, let's just call it g for gravity, but it doesn't really matter. But what would v be, the velocity function? It would be the antiderivative of g, right? So g is some constant, right? So if it's in feet, it would be 32 feet per second, or 9.8 meters per second squared, right? But what would be the velocity function in that case? G what? Well, it's the antiderivative of g, no? Which is what? Remember, g is a constant. So it would be, yeah, just g, well, in this case, t, right? T for time. Dt, and then plus, so in the general case, we just say some constant c, right? But in the context of acceleration and velocity, what would that c represent? That c would represent some initial velocity, right? So here, typically, the way you write it is v naught. So this would be initial velocity, v naught. So, like, for example, if you throw something in the air 10 feet per second, well, it would be 10, right? If you drop something from somewhere, then it would be zero because the initial velocity is zero, right? Okay, now what would be the position then? It would be the antiderivative of the velocity, right? So what would we get in that case? It would be what? GT. What's the antiderivative of GT? Yes? GT squared over 2, no? The power rule? Plus what? V naught T, yep. Okay, and then here you would have another constant, right? So instead of just putting a generic, letter D, what would it represent in this case? Yeah, the initial position, right? Okay, so this would be, say, S naught, and say this would be the initial position, S naught. Okay, and then here, well, here I guess we should put gravity. Let's say minus 32 feet per second squared, or minus 9.8 meters per second squared, right? Okay, so this is the position of a free-falling object, right? And so I think way back when I gave you this function, right? And we said, oh, where did that come from? Well, who knows, right? And then, well, now you know where it comes from. So it comes from the antiderivative. Just starting off with the acceleration, which is a constant, get its antiderivative, and then get the antiderivative again, and that tells you the position. Does that make sense? Yeah? Okay, now, so let's do an example here. How about... What is it? Well, we could do that. But let's do a little bit, something a little bit more fun. Suppose you throw a tomato in the air. How fast? 100 meters per second. At an initial height of, oh, I don't know, 4 meters, let's say. You fall down, and what happens? The tomato falls on your face. Okay. All right, questions. What are some important questions we want to know about this person who got tomato splatted?
Initial velocity of the tomato.
How fast was the tomato? So how fast was the tomato traveling when it hit your face? That's the important question, right? What else? Anything else you guys want to know?
Was it red or green?
I don't know. That's not part of the question. Why did we throw a tomato in the air? That's a good question. I don't know. Why would you throw a tomato in the air? Okay, all right, so what do we need to do? Any ideas? Well, we know the acceleration, right? What's the acceleration? 9.8 meters per second squared, right? Okay, so... also, do we know the initial velocity and the initial position? So what's the initial velocity? 100 meters per second. Good. And then what's the initial position?
4 meters.
4? Okay, good. All right, so then that's all I need, right? So here... well, from this I can find the velocity, right? So what's the velocity? The velocity function. Come on, we just did it. Negative 9.8 t. Plus some, so typically you would do some constant c, right? And then you plug in this case, 0 and 100. So then... in this case, you would get just 100, right? Does that make sense? Okay. And then what about the position function? This would be minus 4.9 t squared, right? Plus 100 t, and then plus? In this case, 4, right? Some constant, and then you plug in s of 0 equals 4, and you get 4. Okay, so what is it that we're looking for then? What do we need to know? If we want to know how fast the tomato was going when it hit our face, we need to know t when what? So we need to find t when what? It's a setup to answer the question. Yeah, when the position equals zero, right? So when the tomato hits the ground, so find t when s of t equals zero. Okay, well, I think we can do that. We'll need a calculator, but that's all right. So just set this equal to zero, right? Minus 4.9 t squared plus 100 t plus 4 equals to zero. And if we get a calculator out, what do we get for that? 2.0801 seconds. Notice we ignored the negative one, right? Well, that's obvious because we don't care about negative time in this case. Okay, now is this the answer to the question?
No.
What would I do with this? Plug into what? The velocity, right? So plug this into velocity. So the velocity at 2.0801 is minus 9.8 times 2.0801 plus 100. And what is that? Is that what I said? Meters per second, right? That's pretty fast. Ooh, that's gonna hurt. Hopefully it's a soft one. Hopefully it's a soft tomato. All right, so any questions with that? So that's just kind of a review of something we've seen before, but it's always a good idea. Now, when we did the applications of the derivative? Oh, or maybe was that one of the things that our sub was supposed to do and he didn't do, maybe?
Possibly, yeah.
That's possible.
Yeah, I think Slingland did it about the stone off the building.
Okay, well, yeah. He maybe didn't do the tomato off the face, but... okay, so let's take a look at just the difference between displacement versus distance traveled. So let's suppose f of t represents the velocity of a particle. At time t. So what's the difference between displacement and distance traveled?
Displacement is how fast it's traveling.
Distance traveled is the absolute value, exactly. Because, so distance traveled is the total distance you traveled. So, for example, let's say you start here. Start here. And then let's say you take 1, 2, 3, 4 steps forward. And then 4 steps forward, 2 steps back. What's the displacement?
2,
right? Because this is the distance from the origin, wherever you started off, right? But what's the distance traveled? Distance traveled was 6, because you took a total of 6 steps, right? So everything, no matter if it's forward or back, you count it as positive. So what's the interpretation of this with the integration stuff we've been looking at? So, I mean, basically what you have is, so like here, if you have, this is velocity, let's say, and this is time. So, and you know, I don't know, let's say we're going from here to here. So this is positive, right? Whatever that area is. And this is negative. Oh, maybe I should change the colors here a little bit. Let's see. Okay. So this is positive and this is negative, right? Okay. So how would I express the displacement as an integral? So the displacement would be, so in this case, let's say we have, this is A, this is B, this is my function f of t here, which represents the velocity. So what would be the displacement? It would be the integral from A to B of what? Oh, sorry. I've been using f of t and then I put v of t. So, yeah, let's just use f of t just to keep it consistent. So it's the integral from a to b of f of t, right? So f of t dt. So in other words, it's the net area, right? So you count the positive as positive, the negative as negative, and that gives you the displacement. So what would be the distance traveled? The integral from a to b of the absolute value of f of t dt. So in this case, basically, you count all of it as positive. So this that's above the x-axis, you count it as positive. And then what's below the x-axis, you also count as positive. Does that make sense? Yes? Thumbs up for that? So any questions with that? No? Is that okay? Okay, so why don't we talk about some other interpretations then. Okay, so for example, so let's say for example that P of T represents the rate of population growth of what? Frogs on Shelter Island. Where T is in, I don't know, years, I guess. Okay, so what does this integral mean? Nope. 2 years to 5 years, that's right. So this 2 and this 5, those are t values, right? So those are Yeah. So I didn't give a starting year, but yeah, so exactly. So notice, so P of t is the rate, right? So much like when we had, like, when it represented velocity, we found its integral. What was that? That was the distance that we had traveled, or the net, or it was the displacement, right? So the net distance that we have traveled. So if it's the rate, in this case, of population growth, then what does the integral itself represent? It's going to be the amount of frogs in this case, right? So this is the amount of frogs. So how would I say that? So the amount of frogs, what? The amount of frogs. Maybe not the amount. Maybe the the change in the number of frogs from year 2 to year 5, right? So it's the amount of frogs, the number of frogs from that point from year 2 to year 5. So like maybe 2002 to 2005. Does that make sense? Yes? No? Kind of, sort of? Okay, let's try another one. Let's say, all right, you guys give me one. Give me a rate, something. Okay, all right, so let's do big D, double D. Double D of T represents the rate at which the national debt, we won't say is changing, we'll just say increasing because we already know where it's going. Okay, so what does, well, we have to say actually, let's see, in what are the units? How about trillions per year? That sounded like a good. All right. So what does, for example, all right, so how about, let's see, what year? We're in 2016. Okay. I don't remember how much, what we're at. What are we at? Oh my gosh. Okay, so we're at 19 trillion, is that right? Okay. Oh wait, not 10. No, sorry. Wait, I messed up the units. We'll just do 10. Okay, like that. Okay, sorry. All right. What does that mean? So what are we saying with what does that integral mean? What are we saying with that? Yeah. The change in the, so this 10, so this is 10 trillion, right? That's the amount. So what is that the amount of? So it's the amount of, in this case, the amount of debt, right? So the debt will increase by $10 trillion from 2016 to 2020. That's what we're saying with that integral. Does that make sense? Yes or no? Probably more, but Well, we just guesstimated. Okay, so questions on that. Any questions? No? All right, so what did you guys come up with? What's the first one? What is that saying?
Total amount the car will depreciate value from 0 to 2 years.
So in the first 2 years, your car will depreciate by $10,000, right? Does that make sense? Okay, good. All right, so in the first 2 years, this car will depreciate by $10,000. All right. What about this one?
Depreciates from having the car from after having the car for 2 years to however long you plan on having the car.
Sort of.
The average rate.
So notice it's a function, right? So this will tell you how much the car will depreciate starting from 2 years to however long, whatever you say, right? Okay, so function that tells you the depreciation amount from 2 to X years. All right, what about the last one? F prime of X. It's the easiest one.
The rate at which it depreciates at that moment.
What is F prime of X? That's just C of X, right? Which is? It's just it's the original function, right? So it's just the rate at which the car depreciates. What is X? It's whatever the year number is, right? Starting at whatever baseline. In this case, we didn't say, so. Well, I guess 0, right? You buy the car 0 years. So, okay, cool beans. So, any questions with any of that? Does that make sense? Is that pretty clear? Okay. All right. Well.